With Jerry McKee. I'm Jerry.
And this is Mike. And this is...
Chelsea.
Ah, Chelsea. I can remember that name.
Now I can, because there's someone that's named Chelsea.
We want to show you some unique stuff. You know, we go around the state, South Carolina and North Carolina. We bring you interesting people and interesting things that people do. And you're going to be interested in this right here. Four phobias that people have. One of the top four phobias. Snakes. Spiders, roaches, and rats. I bet you're scared either one or all. So we're going to educate you. I'm not going to educate you. Mike and Chelsea's going to educate you on all four of these things and teach you some things that you didn't know about snakes, spiders, roaches, or rats. And hopefully you will gain some knowledge. Now I must warn you, we're going to show you how they eat, what they eat, and how the best to feed your pet if you have a pet snake, spider, rat, or roach. But we're going to show you, they're going to show you how to feed them.
Feed them roaches too.
Got to feed roaches. They got to eat to grow, don't they?
Yeah,
so see, everything got to eat. And y'all do some interesting things with the waste. And
with the bioactive,
right.
Bioactive containers down there on the bottom.
And I bet you, I didn't know this either. Did y'all know spiders shed?
Yeah, it's called molting.
Molting. And I've heard that word before.
Yeah.
And we're going to get a close-up of this, too, here in a moment. This, wait till you see a close-up of this. This is creepy to me. But it is so neat. Because I was looking over here when you was moving it. I was saying, they think lives in their weight.
They kind of look just like
they
the
look
spider
just
themselves.
Like,
they do.
The only difference is like you can actually see down.
Wow.
Where their legs pull out.
Yeah.
They pull out.
Yep. And we're going to show you a close-up to this too right here. So I'm going to turn it over to Mike and Chelsea and let them educate you. You don't want to listen to me to educate you because I'll say, run, but don't run. This is really interesting, and if you're thinking about getting a pet of snake or a spider, then these are the folks who's going to tell you. What's the name of your business? And I know you was talking about that earlier, so tell us a little bit about that.
Currently, right now, the name of the business was based off the reptiles, the MY reptiles, but we're in a transition from moving from the reptiles to the spiders and maybe even potentially down the road the exotic cats. So we're going to change the name and incorporate it since she's a big part of it. Now we're going to do it as in C for Chelsea and then MY for Mike Young and then exotic, so it's going to be CMY exotics.
Right.
Or see my exotics.
Now if someone wants to get a hold of you to ask questions, y'all have a website, you have a Facebook page that you
I have Facebook page, which is MY Reptiles, or you can do at Ball Python Life, which will take you to that page on Facebook. I actually have an Instagram that is Mike Young 1070, and once we get the exotic side of the business going, that's going to change too, but
okay.
But for now, that's what I'm using.
All right, and what I'll do, I'll display this where you'll be able to write these things down so that way you can go in and see some of the things that you're doing and also ask the question. Mm-hmm. I'm sure they will be glad to help you with that.
Absolutely.
So right now, I'm going to give you Mike and Chelsea show.
We're just going to start with explain a little bit about the tarantulas. Their Theraposidae is the family name, which just means hairy spiders.
It's interesting though, because they don't actually have hair. It's called setae, but it looks like hair.
Yeah. Pretty much the tarantulas are broken down into two separate groups. New World, which basically is from the Eastern Hemisphere, United States, Canada, South America, and a few islands and stuff, the Caribbean and stuff. And then there's Old World spiders, which Old World is, you know, Europe, Australia, you know, Asia, all that.
Africa.
Another difference with New World is a better for beginner hobbyist. They're usually a lot less, they're docile, they're not fast. Their venom is not really medically significant. It's basically, unless you have
like a
bee sting, unless you have an allergic reaction, it could get a little worse.
Irritating hairs.
The hairs, that they will make you itch. It's like an insulation. It's their way of protecting themselves, and they'll use their back legs if they feel threatened and kick the hair up into a little cloud. And you definitely don't want it in your eyes or breathe it in, because it
can be very irritating.
I had one kick hairs on me one afternoon, and my hand, I didn't have a shirt on. She was standing next to me. It kicked hairs on my arm from the elbows, my hand down on both arms, and across my stomach, and then her arm. I itched for almost 2 weeks, where I ended up using duct tape, laying duct tape where it itched and pulling it up, and hopefully it would get most of it. And it did get most of it.
It's
but
kind of like cactus spines, where they can kind of embed themselves in you, and really the only way to get them out is with, you know, magnifying glass and tweezers. But
yeah, so, and they're hard to see. They're little hairs. They very irritating, like fiberglass.
And the different species have different types of irritating hairs, and some are more agitating than others.
Yeah,
it depends on
three classes,
person.
Three levels of them, and
no.
Okay.
There's kind of four main types of the spiders, and it'll help you a lot to understand what they like to do and when you're choosing a type of enclosure for them. So there's fossorial spiders, which are burrowing, and so they need lots of substrate because they will burrow down, and you may not see them a lot, but when you do get to see them, it's kind of a reward.
Yes.
Then there's terrestrial spiders, which will spend most of their time on the surface. These are some of your best display tees because you get to see them and they're kind of out in the open a lot more.
Like this one here?
That's an arboreal.
What would you?
I was talking about terrestrial.
Oh, you're talking about terrestrial. Oh, she's a terrestrial. That's the big bird eater.
So then there are semi-arboreal tarantulas that usually make their webs at the base of a tree. So they have more climbing capabilities than most of the terrestrials, but are still closer to ground dwellers. And then there's true arboreals, which are more tree dwellers and spend most of their time up in the trees. Usually they'll make web funnels that they live in, and they're much better climbers than the other tarantulas. So that's what this one is here, hanging on the side of the glass.
He's a true tree spider. They live in the treetops.
They essentially have tiny little microscopic hairs that almost function like suction cups that allow them to climb up of even the smoothest surfaces like glass.
A lot of people, I mean, you in nature they have wide open, so they're not confined to a little cage, and everybody says, oh well, why do you keep them such a little cage? Where some of the benefits to have them in a littler cage like this is when it comes time to feeding them, you don't have to wonder if they're eating. They're right there. You can watch them eat and make sure that they eat, so you don't have to chase them all over or look through a big cage for a little tarantula. So it's easier to see where they're at. I guess now we'll do size, different, work our way up from babies. So baby spiders, which slings or spiderlings is what they're called. Sometimes them babies are as small as smaller than a pencil eraser around. I mean, they are just incredibly small when they're born.
And most tarantulas, they can have anywhere from 50 eggs to over 2,000, depending on the species. So you could end up with a lot of spiderlings.
This is one of their molts. And what happens is, as you can see in the center of the body, the spider, when it molts, its carapace pops off and it pulls out all of its legs. And what they do usually is they put themselves on the floor or on the cage upside down and web themselves down and then pull out of it. So then it's webbed down.
So if you ever see your tarantula on its back,
you see its fangs.
Don't touch it. Don't disturb it. It's molting. It's not dead. Tarantulas do not turn upside down when they die. So.
Yeah. It's, most people go, oh no, I think my spider's dying. It's upside down. It's like, no, it's not upside down because it's dying. It's upside down because it's putting on new clothes.
Yep.
Coming out of its old skin. And I don't know if you can see that in the picture, but you see those fangs?
Yep, the fangs are shed as a part of the exoskeleton.
Yep, so, and then her new fangs would be white.
Until they harden up.
Until they harden up, and you can't really feed them until after the fangs harden back up, because it stands a chance of them breaking, because they're soft and white. And they'll go from white to like a red to black, and when they're black, they're good to eat again. The younger spiders only take a couple days.
3 to 5 days before you'd want to feed them after they molt. And the older ones, you want to wait more like 7 to 10.
Now that right there is an old world. And he's back in the corner. He's an old world spider. That's one of the ones that, you know, they don't have the urticating hairs, but their venom is quite potent.
And they're rather endangered in the wild too. Yep. So. Highly coveted by keepers to...
They are technically, they're endangered in the wild. Their natural home is getting populated by humans, and it's running them out. So before long, they'll only exist as pets. This guy here, he is on the side up here on the top left. He is a avicularia, or the pink toe. The ends of all their feet, like this guy here, is a pink toe also.
Uh-huh.
And you'll notice that the ends of all the feet are pink, like somebody painted their fingernails. And he, the big one on the glass here, is a mature male. So a friend of mine has a mature female, and we're actually gonna breed it. His shedded skin like 2 days ago. So in about 4 weeks, we'll introduce them to each other.
She was actually the first tarantula we got.
Yeah, she was our first.
She's a Lasiodora parabona, or an LP.
A common name for her is a pink salmon bird eater. And she is as big as your hand.
In general, tarantulas don't really like to be handled. There are some that are a lot more docile than others and more accepting of it. And just, it's easier to see them that way, and sometimes can help fuel your passion for them, but they're also quite fragile, so especially terrestrial varieties that don't climb as much, so you need to be careful when you handle them, because they can actually
hurt themselves,
rupture their abdomen, and
this is a juvenile. It's kind of hard to see it, but they're this is one of the pink toes, and her toes, it's kind of hard to see, but the ends of all of her toes are pink. She's kind of got a tiger stripe. We call it the booty, the abdomen.
Mm-hmm.
Good beginner tarantula. The problem with them sometimes is they do like to jump. So you got to be real careful, because the tarantulas are very fragile. If they fall from 2 to 3 foot, they could bust open their body. Basically, it's just a harder shell that they work off basically of hydraulics. So it's a harder shell full of liquid. So when their legs move, there is no muscles. They pump fluid to make their legs move. So if you drop them and you crack their abdomen open, they can bleed out. She was taking the dirt and piling it up along the bottom of the door here. So like, hey, don't open my door, I'm blocking you out.
Mm-hmm.
So she was carrying it out of the holes and piling it up on the door, kind of like a little barrier.
And what she was doing is preparing to molt. So she built her burrow, she got herself comfortable, she went inside, she closed off her entrance, and then she actually just molted yesterday. So
yeah, she just molted yesterday, and there's what she,
that's how big she was,
skin.
And now she'll be bigger and beautiful.
She looked pretty good size when I looked at her yesterday.
But we'll definitely respect her space and leave her alone for until she comes out and tells us that she's ready to eat and proceed.
She's down in there. But.
And so tarantulas are sexually dimorphic, and some of them more so than others, in that the males look different from the females. So on an overall level, the males are usually smaller than the females. They might have longer legs, but their abdomen and carapace is smaller in general. And then once they're mature males, they get what's, in most species, get what's called tibial hooks on their front legs, and so they use those for breeding purposes. So it's a really good indicator if a tarantula is a mature male, is you will see those hooks on the front legs.
It's almost like half tubing. Mm-hmm. And what they use those tubes for on the inside of their front legs is when they breed, they take those tubes on the female's fangs and they slide her fangs into those tubes and lift her up.
And then they'll use their pedipalps
to inseminate her into her abdomen. So they got to push her up to get to her abdomen.
And then they run away as fast as possible because she might change her mind and decide to eat him afterwards. It does happen.
Sometimes it happens even before they mate. Mm-hmm. Put the male in and all of a sudden, boom, she jumps on him and kills him.
So it's a really long-term commitment.
You're going to have it today, girl. Come on. You're not going to have it, are
you? But as big as she is, she's always been very gentle with us, and even while breeding, and she's never tried to eat her mate, and she's never tried to bite us. We think it's possible that she might be pregnant, so they do get a little more defensive during that time just to protect themselves and their future babies. And this is one of the species that has some of the most babies, so she can have over 2,000 eggs in her egg sac. That's maybe not the rule, but it is possible.
You're not having it. She's not going to have it today. She is not having it.
And that's part of it, is you just need to recognize when they're not interested in you and respect that.
Yeah.
Just like if a dog was growling at you, you're not going to get all up in its face.
You see size. I mean, she's pretty good size. And she's not even but about halfway to her full size.
But even if you can't handle them, it's just rewarding to be able to watch them and to see how they spend their time and to just appreciate their size and their mannerisms. And they're all different, just like cats and dogs. They all have their own personalities. You can definitely tell with him, he has much longer legs, but is overall much smaller.
And he's just brown and plain. And then she's dark with her elbows on her arms, or different stripe shades and stuff. But they're both exactly the same kind of spider. It's just the difference between a male and a female.
And he's mature, so he's full grown. That's all the bigger he will get. And he's already much smaller than she is.
Yeah, she still ain't really having it, but there's a difference between a male and a female. Well, get back in, girl.
And feeding is something else that you really have to consider based on the size of the tarantula that you're getting and how big it is at the time. They don't need to be fed all that often. When they're smaller, slings and spiderlings, we usually feed them 2-3 times a week, depending on how hungry they seem. You can tell when they're hungry. They prowl their area more, or they just in general look like they're looking for something. So feed a variety of different things. Our smallest slings eat flightless fruit flies. We also feed little mealworms or waxworms, and then as they start to get bigger, they start to go to the superworms, and then we actually have a couple roach colonies as well.
These are just waxworms, and actually these guys are not environmentally safe for the wild, because In the wild, they infest beehives. The moth will lay her eggs in it, and then the larvae eat the bee, the honey, the wax. And I guess that's how they call them, the wax worms. But yeah, you don't want these guys to get out in the wild. We keep them in the fridge because it keeps them, their growth down, so they don't turn into the moth. Now these are Turkish cockroaches.
Yep, they're lateralis.
Red runners.
Red runners.
They can't crawl up the plastic sides. So that keeps them contained.
They're really ideal prey for tarantulas, yeah, too, because they don't burrow in the substrate, they don't climb out, and they're very fast and move a lot. A lot of roaches will play dead.
You ready for this? Gary, the best bet with her, because it's going to happen so fast, is go ahead and focus on the spider.
I don't know whether it'll be better from the top or from the side, but
as soon as I drop it, she's going to jump on it. These guys are them green bottle blues.
Their Latin name is Chromatopoma cyanopubescens. And it's one of the more interesting Latin names because it translates pretty directly to the look of the spider when they're an adult. So it's Chromatopoma, which means like brown butt, and cyanopubescens, which means blue legs.
Back the other way. Come on. Boom. Doo-doo. I wish she'd have been facing this way, but
they don't always cooperate.
And what they'll do too when they grab it like that, she might start doing it. We call it the happy dance, where she'll turn circles and they're laying web down in a like a plate underneath of them. So whatever they have can't actually escape from them.
Essentially, the whole floor of her enclosure is webbed like a little carpet.
So now this is one of them ones I said that you don't want to get bit by. They still make me nervous.
You can see they have the blue and yellow on their underside so that when they rear up in a defensive position that it's got like warning signs basically.
It's number 20.
And they'll essentially grab a hold of the prey with their fangs and inject them with their venom, and then they just suck all of the moisture out of it, and anything that's left, they don't really eat it, they just digest it.
They inject their venom, and then it also has a pretty much digested in the critter, and then it sucks it out.
She's spinning.
Yeah, she's doing the spin now. And the more, usually, typically, the prettier the spider is, the more, I don't want to use the word deadly, but not so friendly it is. So most of the real pretty ones, you don't want to get bit by them kind of thing.
Just like most animals, they use their patterns as warning symbols.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's camouflage, too. You'd be surprised how hard they are to see on certain backgrounds.
Yeah. See its toes? That's why they call them pink toes. And they like to build funnels. This used to be a funnel, but he has kind of destroyed it a little bit after he matured, molted into a mature male. He kind of destroyed it a little bit. Yep.
But you can tell they're, in general, they're pretty docile. They're not trying to hurt you. They're just hanging out. See, she's got dirt in her mouth. She's bringing
she's
more dirt.
She's carrying dirt out. See how she has balled it up and wrapped it in web just to carry it out.
And that one there is webbing in a circle, making herself a nice platform to eat that worm on.
That's what I told them. We call it the happy dance. It's where they and make little circles after they eat, and it's making a little, basically a web plate. So if what they have in their mouth, if they want to set it down, because the tarantulas don't do like spiders will and wrap them up. These are Madagascar hissing cockroaches.
Let's see if you can make them make noise too. Now they can climb the sides. You can see there's tons of babies up in the crevices here.
Make sure there's none on the lids. Now these guys, they get big.
And most people think of roaches as nasty, but they have no smell. They're very cleanly, actually, and they really don't.
Just trying to see if I can find a big male. There he goes.
That's a big male too.
There's a big male there too.
So the males have more pronounced horns.
Yeah, they have like a horns on their head. Distinguishes.
I'm surprised it's not hissing at you.
Yeah. And then they have like 45 to 50 babies each. And like
there's a couple different varieties in here too. You can tell this is like the more normal Madagascar, and the ones like these are zebras.
Zebra. This is the rats, and economically it's much cheaper for us to breed our own than to buy them at $8 to $12 a piece at the pet store.
And we also sell to other people in the area who have snakes or who just want a rat as a pet.
And I have almost all these racks have rats in them, with the exception of this one here. And these guys are from Africa. They're called African soft furs. They are brutal. They will fight to the death. When the males are fighting for breeding, and I'm going to have to, he's pretty beat up.
Mm-hmm.
If you take one out of here and put it in another rack and then decide, nope, I'm going to put it back, and there's babies in that rack, and you put him back, they will kill it immediately. As long as there's babies in that rack, they will not allow anything near them babies. What you got?
I was looking for little babies. She's only got a couple.
Yeah, I think these I got pulled out usually because where Nick was like, little babies.
A whole bunch of them back there.
Yeah, those are
various sizes.
Actually, give me that little clear. It's mm-hmm. in the bucket right there.
It can be kind of difficult to think of them as food because they are very cute and very intelligent.
Yeah, usually if I catch them and I think they're cute, they end up becoming breeders. And
yeah.
So I have some that I keep specifically, but you know, I do about 1,200 babies a month. Move it, girl. And here's what a newborn looks like. I mean, they're little teeny guys. And then they get to the stage where they start getting a little bit of fur on them. Come on, watch it. Get a little bit of fur on them. Watch it. Whoop.
And it's kind of fun to raise them too, because you can play with genetics and
yeah, we play with color patterns and put different ones together. And see, I got all kinds of different sizes in here. So,
very social creatures.
And I have the automatic watering systems on them where I only have to water them once a week and fill the buckets up with water, and it's all done with gravity and nozzles that they just bump the little nozzle and the water runs out. I make my own food, use a base of dog food, wheat, barley, stuff like that, mix that, even use some hog food. Sunflower seeds, sometimes rabbit food. I got whole oats, corn, and I mix all my own food for them instead of just buying store-bought, because most of the store-bought food for rats are
junk. You want to feed your feeders well.
Yeah, I feed my rats well because the snakes are eating them, so I want healthy rats. And
healthy and happy.
And they're close to this size when they're born, sometimes a little smaller. This one was born 7/22 of last year. She's just a real slow grower, and sometimes that happens. And then I have some that were born the same time she was that it a lot bigger,
better eater,
and just sometimes they just don't grow as fast as people would think. Sometimes they grow real fast and sometimes they just don't. But she's kind of got a, like, her side pattern, how it's kind of faded out and very high up on her side. One of my last year's babies is one of my favorites. I'll go ahead and actually run through her, and then we'll feed her.
You have some shed skin in there, too.
Yep, she shed her skin.
And this is what they do. They just ball up like that.
Yeah, it's two of the skins there. And that big skin, the bottom one, is off of one of my big girls. She's I'll show you her in a minute, but this little guy here,
girl.
Was born last year.
7/22.
Oh, it's the same litter as those other guys I was just showing you. It's the same litter, but she's a Mystic Potion, Orange Dream, Inchy combo. So she's four genes in one. And one of the cool things about these guys is this, pull this light. If you put a UV light on her, you can see pattern on her. She's got the stripes and the so.
How can you tell male or female?
I have a kit, it's a probe kit. It's like metal rods that you insert into their cavity, and if it goes in, it's a male. If it only goes in just a teeny bit, it's a female, because what's happening is you're sliding into a pocket that typically holds the penis. With the boy, it would go into that pocket, so you know that it has that pocket, so it's a boy. And what are you doing, girl? You're looking
hungry.
She's hungry. She, okay, fair warning, everybody. Right now, basically, she's just constricting. She grabbed it, wraps
straight
around it,
and
then every breath that it takes, as it exhales, she tightens down so it can't inhale, and then it exhales, and eventually she just, it will stop. It doesn't take it long. It'll stop breathing, and then she'll turn it around and go on it head first and swallow it whole slowly.
The whole process takes, what, 15, 20 minutes?
I think she's quick.
It is a very vulnerable time for a snake when they're feeding. They can't do anything. I mean, they can spit it back up if it's not gone too far.
They'll regurgitate it in a second. Get it halfway down and they feel threatened, they'll regurgitate it and reverse the process real quick.
But it's definitely something they try to make sure they're safe before they start.
There she goes. I knew if I got her to bite on the head, the feeding response takes over with the head in her mouth. She's like, okay, it's going down.
And they can unhinge their jaw, so it's pretty pretty crazy to watch.
Yeah, her jaw's unhinged there. You can see the their bottom jaws are independent. They're not one jaw like yours. It's split in the middle. So they have independent usage of their bottom jaws. And they use that like you would scoop something, bring it to you, scoop something. So they walk it in. And then once they get it down, they use their muscles and they'll twist in an S and push it down in their stomach. And at the very end, I always laugh. It looks like a spaghetti noodle, because once they get it all the way in, their mouth closes, the tail still sticks out just a little bit, and you can watch it as it goes down. I always call it the spaghetti noodle. And then the other way, this way, so they walk it on. And then she'll push her body up on it and then walk it again. So it's like kind of like putting your tight sock on your foot. You kind of pull it and pull it and pull it. And then that's what I call the noodle or the cigarette. See, it's sticking just out of the corner of her mouth, like, There it goes. Now she'll use her body as an S and push that down. Uses her muscles to push it down into her stomach.
And they're surprisingly strong. As little as they look, they can very tightly. Basically, all they are is a big muscle.
And once you feed them, you can't really mess with them for a few days at least.
So this is an incubator for the eggs.
Yeah, this is the incubator, 88 degrees. The eggs are in here for 60 days, 58 days, give or take. These eggs are actually due like next Wednesday, Thursday, Friday.
So this is just vermiculite in the bottom here?
Yeah, it has vermiculite in the bottom to help hold moisture in it. And then I have, it's the same grate that they use in fluorescent lights. Mm-hmm. And I just cut pieces to fit.
You want them to stay humid in there, but not wet.
Now these eggs, like I said, they're getting ready to hatch, and you can see how they're
starting to cave in a little.
They're starting to cave in a little bit. And what happens is the baby snake will pop its head out. It's got a little point on its nose that falls off very shortly after, but they will cut the inside of the egg and stick their head out. Well, they may stay a day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days in that egg with just their head out, absorbing the rest of the yolk. And once the yolk's gone, they just come on out. These are, they were just laid on the 16th. So they're only about 10 days old, but see how they don't collapse as much.
They're so soft.
And the marks on top of them are so you know what's up. Because if you take an egg that is laid in that direction and you lay it back the other direction, it'll die. So when mama lays the eggs, she lays them in a pile and she literally is wrapped around them like a pyramid completely. You can pick her and she brings the eggs with her. She holds on to them that well. Now this this set of eggs was laid by this girl. And they lose about half of their body weight when they lay the eggs, and they'll go months without eating. But she's the mama, and then, yep, very bottom.
There's water.
He'll snip sometimes, so let me get him. He's getting ready to shed too. And there's the daddy. He's getting ready to shed. He's all dark. His colors are all dark. So all the babies, all those eggs right there will either look like him or they'll look like her. There will be nothing else. No normals, no anything like that. And when I say no normals, like this is the first set of eggs I brought out. This was the mama. She lost half of her body weight. She's about 12 pounds normally before she lays her eggs. But she's your typical normal. This is what a normal ball python looks like. Everything else is all morphs, either dominant, codominant, or recessive. These eggs, both parents are recessive genes. So that's why it takes two recessives and they all look like her. So the rule pretty much is visual, bred with a visual, always makes a visual. If I was to breed that orange and white one with her, some of her babies would look like she does, some of them would be that orange, and that would be it, but they all would be recessive for that white pattern. So then if you take those babies that are recessive with that white pattern and breed them back together, they make more of those white patterns, which is what is coming into play on this next set of eggs that I didn't show you. That's a recessive pied, which is the recessive white and brown, with it looks normal, but she's got the recessive, oh, she's real skinny, but she just laid too. She's got the recessive genes for the white. So I bred him with her, so I'll have some that look like her, some that look like the white one, and some that will look like the orange and white one. And it's all a math game on and luck, because I've bred some that were recessive to recessives and get nothing but the normals. So it's all a matter of luck. And so these eggs, this was her first litter or her first clutch ever. So, and I raised her from a baby. So matter of fact, these two are sisters. They came from the same original litter. But she has the white and she just has it as recessive. So breed her with him. He's the recessive. Her recessive should make snakes like her too. And I have, let me put these eggs back up. And right now I have 8, 16, 24. So I have three females that have laid eggs so far this year. This egg here, watch this. I don't know if you can see it, but you see those veins? See the veins in it? That lets you know that they're actually living. So when she lays her eggs, you can put the light on it and you see the veins. And what that tells me is there is a live embryo in there. So if you put a light to them and there's nothing in it, no veins, it's no good. It's a slug. So we always
try to check that,
because if you have one that's not a live egg and you put it in a couple weeks you're gonna know it. Mm-hmm. We all know what a rotten egg smells like.
Is it bad for the other ones too?
Yes, it'll cause rot, it will bacteria and stuff, so it's bad for the other ones. So we always check them. This is an albino girl. She actually laid eggs for me this year, but I couldn't get enough weight back on her this year to risk breeding her again. I didn't want to hurt her, so I decided to let her skip this year on breeding, just because she didn't put enough weight on, and you can see how the belly kind of collapses on her, so she didn't put the weight on like I wanted her to, and it happens sometimes. I would much rather not breed her than risk hurting her. I have a second one down there, another pastel female. It looks like my buddy's, that is the same way. She just didn't put enough weight on this year for me to breed her.
So we'll wait till next year.
Yep. And here, this is my next one that she's gonna lay eggs for me. And she's what they call a yellow belly. And actually, you might even be able to see. She's not gonna let me. Come on, girl. Sometimes you can see the curls of the eggs in her, but she's not. She's tensing up too much just to hang to see. So she's one of them that will lay for me hopefully here soon. This guy here, this is a super pastel lesser female. So she's and I got her from a guy that bred her last year, and again she didn't put weight on this year. So I didn't even consider breeding her either. Big normal. I pulled her out, didn't mm-hmm. I? Yeah. And then this is what they call a spider.
She's kind of cute. She has a heart.
Yeah, she has a heart on her back there as a pattern. Okay. I got her from another friend of mine that decided that he had too many snakes, and so I ended up getting her from him. And she was a little teeny thing when I got her. This is the daddy I put with my buddies. This one's got, it's Moda Pewter. He's a boy. He's Moda Pewter Mojave. And the Pewter is a cinnamon, pastel cinnamon. She's on the roof.
I know.
Is a pastel cinnamon. So it's a four gene snake. So to put him with his pastel, which is a one gene, you have anything from, you can have one gene all the way up to five gene. So stand a chance of having anything in between, a mixture of all kinds. Showed you the Mojave. She didn't put enough weight on for me this year to breed either. But and she's getting ready to shed. So again, like instead of risking the animal's health out of my greed, I'm not gonna do it. And then he's kind of pretty. Come here, Bubba. He was a big daddy last year. He was sired a lot of my younger ones, because again, he's an Orange Dream Inchy Mystic, which is multiple genes, so you get all kinds of crazy stuff out of him. And I did not breed him this year. I just stuck with this one here. This is a super vanilla, and they're all ball pythons. It's just different morphs. This is considered a super vanilla, and he's a male. And we saw the banana. Oh, you know what? The female maker. Mm-hmm. That's something interesting. You want to shoot him with some water?
I'll get it.
Yeah, right behind you. So, okay, so this is what they call a banana. And like the boy that's white over there, he's a banana pied, which is the banana with the white. This is just the banana. The curious thing about the bananas are that if you take a male banana boy and breed him with a female banana, it will all be boys. They will not produce any females. So a banana male only makes males. So occasionally you get what they call the female maker. So she's a female that you can put a banana to and they will make females. So price wise, she's about three times as expensive as that boy is, because all he'll do is produce males. She will produce females. So most bananas are males. Has he shed recently? Yep, good. This guy here, come here, Bubba. If you look at him just right in the light, you can see rainbows. And he's what they call a leopard. He's a pastel leopard. Mm-hmm. He was daddy to some of these babies that I have here last year. I think it's this one. Hey, come here, Bubba. See, this is one of his babies from last year. So you see the... And of course, that's why they call them ball pythons. But he's kind of got that leopardy look. And I got a little boy, albino. And now the females have to be 1,700, 1,800 grams before you can breed them. Now the boys, right there, they don't have 600 grams. The boys, they stay smaller. Females will get really big and fat. The males kind of stay skinny. Usually don't get as big.
Well, I know you see some interesting things, and you shouldn't have no phobia now, especially when the roaches. You know, that was, to me, out of all of it,
that
was my creepiest.
Really?
Yeah, the little bitty ones. The mascot's cart, I mean, everybody knows what a mascot's cart. That's the island over there, and all these fun animals come from. So.
Yeah, they actually have... I don't know how many, but hundreds of different varieties of animals that are nowhere
indigenous.
Else in the world.
Yeah, it's strange. I really appreciate y'all too, Kelsey and Mike, for y'all's wonderful hospitality and showing us all these things. And tell the people, how many snakes do you have right now?
I think it's about 47.
Yeah.
47?
Mm-hmm.
And how many spiders?
30 tarantulas.
30 tarantulas.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you got some babies in there too, right?
Well,
the tarantulas aren't true spiders. So there's 30 tarantulas total.
Okay.
There's a difference between a spider
then
and a tarantula.
Mm-hmm.
I should have known that. I just watched you. How many rats do you have? Yeah.
Adults.
So they don't have to worry about burglars at all. Even going into the garage, they're going to pull out and see rats and sneak in the house. They're going to see snakes and spiders. And they got a beautiful big lab that's their alarm system.
Yeah.
So y'all got it pretty well covered.
And actually, technically, you haven't even seen the Bengals yet.
Yeah. We got six cats also.
Six cats. That one's a beautiful cat. He showed me a picture.
Yeah, he's an F1 Bengal. So.
Oh, gosh, he's so beautiful. Well, thank you all for watching. I hope you've learned something and didn't get creeped out or anything like that. We just want to show you, you know, how the correct way to have a snake or a tarantula, the best way to house them, to feed them. And so if you have any questions, we will put up Mike's Facebook page. You can ask him a question directly. He'd be glad to answer. And who knows? You might want one of his snakes that he's breeding, and he gets partial to them now.
He
loves them. But thank you for watching. I'm Jerry McKee, down home, and we will see you next time. Who knows where we'll be next time? Sasquatch. That's where. That's where we're going to go to Tennessee and look for Sasquatch.